kinds of issues having to do with urban affairs in the U.S., notably about the dispersion of the urban poor in the book that he wrote for the Urban Institute several years ago.
I think I'm right here.
And it's new to the international sphere and the comparative planning field, which is obviously extremely exciting field to be in. And it, as everybody now knows from people's introductions, took a group to Tanzania last year and plans to do it again this academic year. And he's going to offer his remarks today on urban planning challenges. It's going to be urban, and originally it was going to be Dar es Salaam, and now you're going to, I think you're going to try to generalize a little into the rest of Sub-Saharan Africa.
Not really.
But let's wait to see what he does. Anyway, right. Great to have you here.
All right. Thanks a lot, Bob. Appreciate it. Thanks to all of you for coming. Appreciate it. I will say up front that about 5 years or so ago, then Dean of the Humphrey School, Brian Atwood, gave a charge to faculty members to think about where our fields would be in 10 years and what we would need to be teaching and dealing with in the classroom. And so the group of us who do work in urban planning and policy got together, and it was quite clear to us that urbanization around the world was going to be a big factor, that rates of urbanization in Asia and in Africa and elsewhere were so great that we really had to internationalize the curriculum. We had to investigate and interrogate the kind of problems faced by urban areas around the country. And so, of course, one of the ideas that emerged from that was that we should take students to various parts of the globe to see firsthand what is transpiring in some of these areas. And so that's how the trip to Dar es Salaam was created. How I got to be the person to take 10 students there is another thing altogether. And
you volunteer.
What's that?
You volunteer.
Sure, I volunteered by dint of having the idea that it should happen. And so let that be a lesson to all of you. So Dr. Cooley suggested, my career has been in domestic issues related to urban development and urban planning, and so I don't have a broad or a deep background in international development. What I know and what I will present today comes from a couple of trips to Dar, as well as about 8 months of reading on Dar. So I'm pretty sure that there are people in this room with both a deeper and a broader understanding of the situation in Dar. And so I invite you to chime in and add to the conversation at any point. So I think we can take questions or comments as we go along. I want to begin with this notion of the century of the city. You know, sometime in the past 5 years, the global population tipped from predominantly rural to predominantly urban, so that over half of the population on the planet now lives in urban areas. And while this has been true in developing parts of the world for years and decades, it's been the tremendous rates of urbanization in Africa and Asia that have really tipped the scale globally in terms of urban population. And you can see that that the rates of urbanization are really fantastically high. It's we've never experienced anything really quite like this in the United States ever. Even in the periods of the most rapid urbanization, you don't see the number of people nor the rate of urbanization as high as you see in parts of the globe these days. And the rates of urbanization are greatest actually in Africa. This is simply an annual average rate of change in urban population over the past 50 years or so, and you can see that actually for that entire period of time, Africa has led the way in the rate of urbanization. Now, partly that has to do with the fact that it was starting at a smaller base. But you can see that it has sustained its place as the most rapidly urbanizing part of the world for a long period of time. And many observers now argue that although historically urbanization has always taken place in concert with economic development and economic growth, that those two processes have been sort of decoupled in Africa recently, where you continue to see high rates of urbanization, but without economic expansion or without the same kind of economic development. And this is then causing, of course, some significant issues for a lot of cities. So here you see growth of African cities. The light blue is the population in 2000. The green around it is describes the population 2025. You can see Dar es Salaam in Tanzania and East Africa over here. Already sort of one of the largest cities in the east, and along with Nairobi is going to be growing significantly over time. That having been said, and of course these pictures of global megacities like Lagos and Kinshasa and Cairo, they seem to dominate our understanding of urbanization. Most of the growth over the next 20, 30 years will actually take place in medium-sized cities, even as small as 200,000, 300,000 people throughout Africa. Dar es Salaam is now estimated at somewhere between 3 and 4 million people. I believe there will be a census done in the next couple of years where they hope to get a more precise sense of the size of the city. But in Africa, urbanization takes place in the context of really sort of underdeveloped governmental capacity to deal with a lot of the issues. So what I'm showing here is an index created, I believe, by the United Nations that measures essentially level of economic activity, infrastructure capacity, waste treatment capacity, education, and health in the ways that are described, and showing that African cities compare unfavorably to cities in every other part of the globe. And again, this has to do with level of economic development, but also governmental capacity in these areas. And so what you have is really very challenged public sectors facing very high rates of urbanization. And so there are significant challenges. So I'll talk really today about Dar es Salaam and about what and about three particular challenges that we can focus on in that city. Dar es Salaam was first settled actually by the Sultan of Zanzibar in the late 19th century, who wanted a place of retreat from Zanzibar, which is ironic because now people leave Dar es Salaam to go to Zanzibar for a break. But it was then colonized by the Germans and made into their administrative center of East Africa in the late part of the 20th of the 19th century and early part of the 20th, taken over then by the British after World War I, and gained its independence in 1961. Tanzania gained its independence in 1961. Dar, for most of the 20th century, then was the largest city in Tanzania, and it can, I think, accurately be described as a primate city. It's many times larger than the next largest city. It was the capital for many years. It certainly is the economic capital of the country. For most of the post-colonial, at least for the first couple of decades of its post-colonial history, it was a socialist country, and so it did not develop traditions of market provision, traditions of private land ownership and speculation that developed in other areas. It's been stable politically for most of its independent history, but again, it does have historically underdeveloped markets and a commercial center, and somewhat as a result, it has very weak systems of revenue generation in the public sector. There's simply, to take an example for local government, property tax revenues are really quite low. There's no effective system in place for gathering those kinds of tax revenues. There are very few property records in place. Streets, ever since probably the mid-70s, remain sort of unnamed. Central and the local government are at odds with each other about how to deal with people who don't pay their property taxes. There's no way to collect the taxes, etc. So you've got a pretty underdeveloped and malnourished public sector attempting to govern a population that is rapidly growing, is about 3 million. So 3 million people. So Dar es Salaam is right on the coast of the Indian Ocean. There's a very nice and sheltered harbor here. There's a port here. It's the second largest port in East Africa. Does a significant amount of business. The main city center is located right here. What I want to note here is that for all intents and purposes, there are really four roads out of downtown. There is the oldest road in the city, Bagamoyo Road, which continues up the coast to the north. Morogoro Road out to the west. This road that parallels the railroad and goes past the airport to the southwest, and then a road, a trunk road to the south. This is, again, I want to emphasize for a city of 4 million people, four main escape routes from downtown. It gives you a sense of, and I'll talk about it more, but it gives you a sense of an underdeveloped transportation infrastructure, which I'll focus on in a little bit. I think we can, the country went through an economic crisis in the late 70s and the early 80s. After Nyerere was succeeded, then the country essentially adopted some structural adjustment remedies from the IMF, and really sort of adopted as austerity measures, cut the public sector significantly, and many who take a look at the development of Dar es Salaam suggest that the significant austerity measures and the shrinking of the public sector in the 1980s led also to a sort of a widespread neglect of infrastructure and the decline of the infrastructure in the city, and certainly forestalled any expansion of the infrastructure. And I think in the 1970s, the city still had not reached 1 million in population, but it's grown since then from one to close to four. And so the fact of the matter is, and it's ironic, but that the city was much better planned in its first 50 years than it was in its last 50 years of existence. Again, this is the ocean out here. Here's the sheltered harbor. But when it was first settled by the Sultan of Zanzibar, he created the first settlement essentially right here, which is still called sort of the old Majid section of town. When the Germans came in, they settled the European section out here, which faced the ocean breezes. But also you can see a difference in the streetscape between the colonial section of town and the older section of town. The colonial section, wider streets, trees lining the streets. The Germans actually very specifically tried to mimic some of the broader boulevards of Berlin, etc. The Africans were shunted to the western part of the what has now become the downtown, and as was common in a lot of African colonial cities, there was an open space that was enforced between where Africans lived and where Europeans lived. This open space is about, I can't remember exactly the size of it now, I do remember reading that it's about as far as a malarial carrying mosquito can fly. And so the idea being that that one would be buffered from the disease. But there was also then the buffer of this old Majid section, which became settled by traders from India. And so the Europeans had the Indian population, and then the open space, and then the African population. But what's interesting is this remains the center of government in the city. This is the old town, as close as you can get to the old town. And this has developed into the most densely populated part of the entire city. It's called the Kariakou section. I'll show a slide of it in a second. But you can see the grid layout here. I've talked about the planning that the Germans and the Brits undertook here. The Sultan planned this section. Lots of good and effective planning early on. Not so much since, and we'll talk about why that's the case. I will focus then on three urban planning challenges: transportation, housing, and then the environment. And so we'll talk about that. So begin again with the map and this sense of a vastly underdeveloped road system in Dar es Salaam. As I said, sort of four effective ways to get in and out of the city. And there isn't much of a road hierarchy. This is just a sort of a classic city center street. This is part of the old Majid section of town. So it's that center section between the European and the African section. And so there's a downtown section that would be familiar to Westerners who haven't been to Africa. Then there are the trunk roads that radiate outward from the central city, and also there are about two rings of connector roads. Two things that are notable here: one, you can see the traffic going in that direction. These automobiles are not moving. And in fact, where's the walker? This guy. In 10 minutes, this guy was about a quarter mile ahead of this truck. Because the truck was still there and the walker was moving on. The second thing is you'll see the drainage system. You see a frontage road here, so the main trunk road. And then behind me when taking the picture is essentially commercial activity that is also mirrored on the other side of that street. So as I said, there are a few of these major trunk roads. This is old Bagamoyo Road, the northern road out of town. And again, this one is really two and a half lanes of traffic, again with commercial activity on the side. But this one obviously isn't as developed. There's not the frontage part of it as well. Beyond that, once you get off the main trunk roads, which you can count on a couple of hands, you've got unpaved roads that get you out into areas of settlement and residential areas, and you know for most of the year these are perfectly functional. For certain parts of the year they're less functional. This was a picture taken in May, which is at the end of the rainy season, and this is a tourist DoubleTree hotel out on the peninsula just north of the city. So it's a tourist area,
at least partially, and you can see the shape of the roads. We went through a number of places that had roads like this. I gotta tell a story. I went there with the students, and we always went everywhere in a little van, but I wanted the students to experience these little, I'll show a picture, I'm showing a pejage, a little sort of converted, it's almost like a golf cart type of conveyance. And so we'd only fit two or three students to a pejage, and so I watched them go off, and then I went in the last group. And it turns out that the second group got stuck in the middle of one of these big water holes because, of course, you can't tell where the real divots are in the hole, and that's not a very large automobile, the Pejage, and so the front tire got stuck in a big rut, and there my three students were marooned in the middle of that, of a big, but they loved it. They enjoyed the experience. Again, this is the road system. The green here are unpaved regional roads, paved regional roads, and then mostly paved trunk roads. And again, while this might look like a pretty well-developed road network, we're talking about a city of almost 4 million people and the commerce that's associated with that. And so the result is traffic everywhere you go. So, you know, line of cars as far as you can see off around the corner, and this is in the Carriaco section of downtown. There's an 11 kilometer stretch from the airport to downtown, and in most according to a traffic survey in 2007, the typical time is 27 minutes to travel 11 kilometers. Bagamoyo Road going north, that same traffic survey charted a 16-kilometer stretch, which took 30 minutes, an average of 30 minutes. And then Morogoro Road, the road out to the west, essentially the same, 30 minutes for just under 20 kilometers. Another traffic study counted 2,300 dollars entering downtown. I'll show you what a dollar is in a second. It's a bus. It's 2,300 entering downtown from a single road from the south per day. You know, that's I think that's close to 100 an hour for a 24-hour period. Certainly for a 23-hour period. And you multiply that by the four entries, it's just tremendous congestion downtown. Sorry, this is a dollar right here. And it's a little bigger than a dollar. That may be actually, you're right, that may be an actual bus. Here's a dollar. This is a Pejage. All right, so is a Boda. This is a regular, essentially taxi, but the operators of Daladalas and the Pejage, they are all licensed operators of these transit conveyances. And so the number of...
They're not licensed, right?
They are licensed. They are indeed.
Oh, yeah.
They're supposed to be licensed.
And do they carry just three people, or do they carry, as many as...
Well, they can, on occasion, carry more than three, and on occasion do, and these, you know, you can see on the route, just sort of... really quite full, overburdened one might skip. And the number of private vehicles, yeah.
No, I'm sorry, I'm trying to see what this looks like in my mind's eye, this level of traffic. Is there ever a time when it calms down?
There are, yes, it's really rush hours, but rush hours extend a long time. And so if you're in downtown after 4 p.m., you might as well stop, have a dinner at a restaurant, and leave at 7, because you'll get to your destination at roughly the same time. So it's so there are periods in the day when it does reduce. I don't know that it ever sort of disappears, because I've had some long trips at various points of the day, but certainly it's the worst in the identifiable rush hour. Anyway, the number of private vehicles is expected to grow in Dar over the next several years. The government is desperately trying to expand the transportation system, but it turns out that there are 15 separate agencies that handle various aspects of transportation policy in the city, and there doesn't seem to really be any coordinating mechanism. There is a Dar Rapid Transit Authority, which is instituting looking into developing bus rapid transit, which would essentially begin again. This is downtown, and shoot out. I think this is Morogoro Road, and out westerly, and then up to. These are two transportation terminals, a little more distant from downtown. The development of the system, as well as the development of wider roads, is hampered by the fact that the government is not anxious to expropriate the land that would be required to build these systems. The Tanzanian central government really is not as inclined as other countries are to displace residents, and there's probably a good historical explanation for that. It's just that the central government is often at odds with the city, because the city, of course, has the greatest vested interest in improving the situation. So the city is a little more aggressive. But there are occasions when the federal government has actually stepped in and reversed decisions at the local level about displacement and widening. Let's move to housing so I can get through all of this.
That's the size of the dollar. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
It's a little big, a little small, but.
It is a little small. Okay, well, at some point we might see an actual bill. 75 to 85% of the residential development in Dar es Salaam is informal. Kariakou is, of course, the biggest exception to this, and you can see these high-rise apartment buildings, if you can recall the map, you saw the sort of the dense grid system there, and this is an area of significant and dense city living, but it is by a long shot the exception to the settlement pattern in Dar es Salaam. Most of it is informal. Most of it is fairly low density, and part of that has to do with the lack of a comprehensive sewer system, which means that high densities are simply not possible. Because of the lack of sewer capacity.
Now, is this right in the middle of the grid somewhere?
Yeah, yes it is. And the second thing that has affected the spatial pattern of Dar is the underdeveloped road system, because it's led to essentially ribbon development. This is the mid-1980s, again, this is downtown, and what you see, it's a little hard to see, but what you see is sort of the spreading of development along these road corridors, simply because of the lack of sufficient transportation and road infrastructure in between. There's not this uniform outward movement. It is it's the settlement along these large patterns, and then sort of inward from there as development occurs. So both the sewer and the road system accounts for the spatial pattern of the city. But as I said, about 75 to 85% of the residential development is informal. What you don't see is a lot of this, though. So when you think about informal slum or squatter settlements in African cities, in Nairobi, elsewhere, you think of the corrugated tin structures. This was a picture I took in Dar, but it's an exception. The reason, and this is located actually in an area, a low-lying area that gets flooded at least once a year, and so that's what accounts for the temporary nature of this particular structure, is because it is sort of regularly rebuilt. Instead, what most of the informal structures look like in Dar es Salaam are structures made of cinder block, and they're really quite permanent looking. And the reason for this is generally because of the government's policy of non-intervention here. And I'll get more to that later. What this gives rise to, of course, is a cinder block industry. Which is sort of mining some of the riverbeds and areas to create what can, you know, become fairly sophisticated residential structures. This one isn't entirely occupied yet, but the structure's in place. You know, flying into Dar and flying over the city, you see a lot of structures that have rooms. With no roof, right? These are rooms that have been built. They are going to be occupied. The family will sort of move into those areas, but it's not quite finished yet. And so in the interim, you see people stockpiling their cedar blocks, buying them, purchasing them as they can, and then constructing their units in a progression. Yeah.
I was just curious to know, do these informal structures also have any drainage system and latrines?
Right. Not initially. Initially, this is just settlement on vacant land. And in fact, you then, on hillsides and elsewhere, but you can see the development of significant settlements. Now this is, you can see the electrical wires coming. This has become serviced over time.
But yeah, that was another question I had. Where do they get the electricity from? Is it just,
Right. Basically, for most of Tanzania, the planning and the development process is sort of backwards of what we think about. In a formal residential development process, there's the planning of the community. There's the development of the infrastructure that will serve it. There's the construction of the housing, and then there's occupation, right? But in informal, it's essentially the opposite. That is, the first step is the occupation of the land by the folks. The construction and, as I said, the staged construction of the housing units. And then the government comes in and provides services and infrastructure development in sort of a catch-up mode almost all the time. And so the creation of the infrastructure and the services lags behind the development of the housing. And the degree to which it lags depends on the funding available in the World Bank assistance, etc.
Are people able to ever get any title to the land?
It's a long and arduous process. And some pursue it and then become acknowledged owners of the land, and some don't. But it's not an easy process.
And as people are occupying, are they creating a sense of pathways and boundaries?
Absolutely. I mean, they're creating communities as they're going along. And so there, new structures are fit into existing environments, and really, it's sort of the accepted way of development, and so everybody knows that it's more or less permanent.
Are these structures legalized at any point?
The legal status of most squatters in Tanzania is vague. There hasn't been definitive court rulings, definitive government action, but in a de facto sense, they are acknowledged as legitimate occupiers. It's only in rare occasions. It's not that the Tanzanian government never displaces squatters. I think there have been displacements near the port area where some of the land was meant for economic development. But in outerlying areas of vacant land, remember, from the years of socialist government, there's very little private ownership of land. And so there's no land-owning class to object to the occupation of vacant land, right? And so the government understands that it doesn't have the resources to make housing happen for the population. So it understands that this is the way it's going to happen. People are going to occupy land, and then the government comes in after the fact to service these areas. And so what happens? Squatting, first of all, and informal occupation is not just for the poor in Dar es Salaam. It is, again, the dominant way that that housing takes place. Building permits are extremely costly and very time-consuming in Dar, and I've spoken to people who with incomes, high enough to follow the formal process, but who don't do so because of the time and the energy involved in the activity. So then what the government does primarily in housing is this infrastructure upgrading of existing settlements. And they have a couple of ways of doing this. Their own literature suggests that they choose sites that have the highest density development, that have nearby income and employment opportunities so that the settlements might have a chance of being viable economically. But also they take into account the severity of economic problems and epidemic diseases that may be in place. So they much of this is funded by the World Bank. They create technical support teams of engineers and planners. They create community planning teams in all of these areas as well. Remember, these are already settled areas. And so they go in and they develop, they divide these zones into smaller zones, 10 to 12 smaller zones of about 2,000 residents each. They elect community planning teams. I was told by the woman at the city council, they elect one woman and one man. I'm not sure what the origin of that policy is, but she was very adamant about that. These representatives are given training on the goals of the upgrading process. Then they call meetings. These community planning teams call meetings of residents. They're given a map of their zone, and they're given a budget by the city. And so they're told to make choices between which roads are going to be tarmacked, I guess, which roads will be gravel, which roads will be walking paths, where they will be located. And they create their own plan for their zone. And then that plan goes back to the city, at which point there's a negotiation that takes place, because the city, of course, has to map that zone's plan with the next zone's plan and to keep it all within budget. But there is a significant sort of decentralization of participation in the process. It's also after the community planning process. It goes back to the city. There's negotiation between the community planning team and the city about lighting, about drainage, and about water availability and toilets, sewer capacities.
So that system's not really any different in a way than the system we have here. If you looked at the NRP system in Minneapolis, other than that there's a built environment, community groups are replanning.
Well, the planning process, right, this planning process, that's correct. That's correct. That's right. So what you have then is this creation of a very conscious road hierarchy with the tarmac roads that carry the heavy traffic and trucks, the gravel roads, and again you can see a couple of things here. This is an upgrading, or you can see the drainage ditch that was built here, and it's on the other side of the road as well. You can see that electricity has been brought in as well. I can't see any water hookups in this photo, but they will also bring water in as well. Here's another sort of secondary road, again a bit smaller, drainage on one end. This will be one-way traffic, but it will hold vehicles all the way down to essentially walking paths. All right, and you know, it's this hierarchy that is negotiated between community members and the city during the upgrading process. The city's literature and everything that the city says is that it tries to minimize displacement. For some of these roads, of course, the tarmac roads, the wider ones, require partial demolition. So you can see this structure has had its front half shaved off. And this one either had the same or is about to have the same, and that's simply a road widening. So that, because this is going to become one of the main avenues in this particular settlement. And so the family here is not displaced. They are compensated for the loss of the partial loss of their structure, but they are not made to move, and they may then add room to the back of their settlement if that's possible as well. The upgrading typically does not include individual sewer or toilet facilities. There may be central toilet facilities located in the settlement somewhere. Interestingly, and probably understandably enough, that's subject to the same NIMBY response that that locally unwanted land uses get, universally, right? Nobody wants the privy next to their place. But here you can see, so what do most people do? They dig a privy on their property, and when it's filled, they cover it over and they dig another one next to it. So that type of, it's serviced by electricity. A water probably nearby, but not the toilet facilities as well. All right, let me. We're running out of time. Sorry about that. And so I'll go to the environmental sustainability. The rapid rates of urbanization, the rapid rates of land consumption, really lead to a number of environmental issues. First of all, there's an inability to keep up with. With solid waste management, and so you see that sort of proliferation of dump sites at the edge of, and sometimes not at the edge of, some of these informal settlement areas, and these can of course leach chemicals and materials into the ground, into groundwater as well. The whole country is suffering from land degradation. Desertification of the land is a pretty widespread issue throughout Tanzania, not so much an urban issue, but access to good quality water certainly is. There's both a shortage of that kind of water and an inadequate delivery system for that water as well. There's a significant amount of contamination of groundwater by effluent disposal, by leakage from waste facilities. And every wet season, the city suffers from a significant amount of waterborne diseases. You can't drink the tap water in Dar es Salaam. So, there's environmental pollution. There's particulate pollution in the air from vehicles standing idling for long periods of times in congested. 80% of the industries in the region are located along the coast in Dar and just in from the coast. It's estimated that 70% of the industries pollute directly or indirectly into the Indian Ocean. Garages, dump sites, car washes, all of these are draining into the water system. Mining uses hazardous chemicals, which again also leach into the groundwater systems. And it impacts urban agriculture. This is a kind of a crummy map, but in terms of its in terms of your ability to read it. But again, here's downtown. The dark blue are places of urban agriculture. You can see it spread throughout the city, including in low-lying areas that are prone to flood. But studies have been done that show high levels of contaminants in some of the locally produced foods. One of the lectures that we heard when we were there was from an environmental scientist who had done a study showing high levels of chemical contaminants in the food produced. There's loss of habitat and biodiversity, mostly from the sort of the peri-urban development that takes place with a rapidly growing metropolitan area, clearance of forests and woodlands, as well as erosion of coastal areas as well. Again, remember, Dar is right on the ocean. The city itself is vulnerable to flooding in a large number of spots. The coastline is eroding. The city and the government are trying to put in place mitigating measures to try to protect coastlines as well. There's residential development in hazardous areas that are prone to flooding, as well as the kind of leaching in the soil. So these are all monumental challenges. They'd be monumental challenges for a well-functioning, well-resourced government, right? And while you may have a well-functioning or at least a functioning government, it's certainly not well-resourced. And so the city, it's trying to catch up in transportation. It has institutionalized catch-up in housing, following around already settled sites to try to service them, and is now beginning to take measures in these environmental areas as well. But the lack of resources means that their effectiveness and ability to address these issues is going to be severely limited in the future. So open up to questions. Yeah.
This, I know, wasn't what you were principally focusing on, but I'm sure a lot of other people were curious. What are the livelihoods? I mean, you mentioned along the way some of the things that people did, but how would you characterize how many people are gainfully employed, how much of the time of all of this great community?
Sure. Most of the employment, so there are industries in Dar, along the railroad section in the south part of town. There is government employment as well. But the most common form of employment engagement is in the informal sector. So the shops that you see lining some of the streets, some of the merchants actually in the downtown, and then the people who sort of ply goods along the highways are all engaged in informal marketing of goods. Again, one of the lectures that we heard when we were there was from a professor at the University of Dar es Salaam, got his PhD in sociology from the University of Minnesota, who does research on the informal sector. He described an extremely intricate system of middlemen in between the person that you see on the street and the actual producer. He likened it in structure to the drug trade in American cities, where you've got those on the streets who are actually selling the drugs, then you've got the middlemen who supply the sellers, And then you've got the traders above them, and then you've got the sort of those who are controlling the market. But he describes an intricate hierarchy. He describes a kind of an intricate sort of, you might call it, business plan. That is, they sell different goods in the morning to people who are driving in, and they sell in the afternoon when you're driving back home. They'll sell different goods on some streets that go to more affluent parts than they do on other streets that are going to more modest residential areas. So they're tailoring their trade in ways that resemble that are understandable and rational.
When you're looking at a city like Dar es Salaam, it was planned for a while, and then a lot of growth is unplanned. So when you're essentially trying to rezone the city, smaller pockets can be rezoned without displacing people. But if you want to do like a good job of rezoning it, then it involves displacing a lot of people. And it's usually the informal sections that take a hit. So how do you rezone a city and ensure at the same time that, you're not just bringing up the informal sections of the city and transporting them somewhere far from the main hub, and you don't
ghettoizing
the city once again?
Well, how do you do that? You mean generally, or how have they done that in Dar es Salaam? In Dar es Salaam, they haven't really changed land uses very much, and so they haven't really done what you would consider a rezoning. There are parts of the city that they want to have maintain their character, so the port area, the industrial areas, and so they will enforce that by displacing squatters. But otherwise, they're essentially it's ad hoc and unplanned development for the most part, and part of that is possible because there's still a lot of vacant land in the area. And as I mentioned, the development has taken on this sort of corridor shape. There are ways of sort of filling in along there. It's low density development for the most part as well. So they've been able to avoid that.
Deborah? So Ed, how does corruption affect urban planning and development in Dar, from what you've heard?
Well, this would only be from what I've heard, although I've got a good story as well. And that is, I think it delays progress in certain areas. So I've understood or been told that some of the transportation issues and the lack of progress on some of this has to do with the inefficiency of bureaucracies and other sorts of unsavory activities within the bureaucracy. I've heard that some of the activities in the port are also subject to, but this is all secondhand information that I have, and my guess is that it does lead to some. It's a minor story. I went to get a map of Dar. I wanted, and it's in my office. It's a big wall-sized map, and when I finally found the map, found the place, and I was told that it cost 25,000 Tanzanian shillings, and so I calculated that was about, I can't remember what it was, 10, 15 bucks, and I thought that was okay. I could pay that. But then on the receipt said 4,000 Tanzanian shillings. And I noticed that, and so I inquired as to the discrepancy between the 4 and the 25, and was told that I would have to pay the 4. I said, you mean I pay the 4 now, and then the rest when I pick it up tomorrow, because the map wasn't going to be ready tomorrow. And she said, no, you pay the bursar 4 and you pay the rest to me. She was very upfront about it, and I had no alternatives. So, But you know, part of that has to do with the fact that, you know, she's underpaid, you know, government salaries have been slashed and cut for a long period of time. And that's not an especially egregious form of corruption. Yeah.
Do they have a sense in the informal housing? Is it intra or extra? I mean, are people coming from the countryside in Tanzania? Are there people coming from the
Yeah, no, it's a significant rural-urban migration still occurring. So it's a number of things. There's the natural population growth. Then there's the growth of the city, which swallows up what had been rural areas, and they become urban. So everybody there becomes an urban dweller now. And then there's the rural to urban migration. So it's a combination of all three of those.
Yeah, it's not a question. I just wanted to point out, I mean, to add on how corruption contributes to the underdevelopment. I mean, with all the, apart from the underpayment of the government officials, well, people could still do, I mean, the correct thing, but if one has to pay like an extra amount to acquire a land illegally, so that just diminishes the ability for the institution to like distribute the land in a way that is supposed to be planned. And it has been happening in many areas. Like the land is supposed to be divided, and so the department that is supposed to do that is deliberately delaying to do that. So people end up those with more money end up paying the extra to the corrupting to be able to get that land. So others end up with no plot to build on, and that way they just have to acquire somewhere else where there is no planning. So it's quite challenging. And also there are some, many roads that have been built like under poor quality because some of the money has been spent on other things when it was supposed to be spent on the roads. So, anyway, just...
Thank you.
Can you say anything about the lives of children in the informal settlements you're talking about, particularly educational infrastructure?
Well, I can't say very much about that. I do know that in the two or three settlements that we toured, we saw schools right in the middle of them, and were there as those schools let out, and they seemed well attended to me. Unfortunately, I don't have any information about the schools.
I just wondered if they followed the development of the settlements like you described other infrastructure following. I presume that that's
yes,
the case.
Yes, there would be as well.
When we use this material to engage our students here in the U.S. in urban planning, what importations do you want them to make of it?
Yeah. Well, the first thing is that what I did with the students for the week or so, this trip took place last May, so during the May session, and we met for a week here in Minneapolis for about 3 hours a day, talking about general issues of global urbanization and development. And so we focused on Asia and Africa. We then narrowed our view to specifically to Africa, and then we focused on Tanzania. I gave them a sort of history of Tanzania that I could give them from the sources I had. We then went to Dar, and we were only there for about 8 days. And in the mornings, we heard lectures from faculty members at the University of Dar es Salaam and at Ardi University, which is the local urban planning and architecture school.
And then we spent the afternoons doing site visits that were appropriate to whatever we were hearing in the morning. And so this simply, I think it's my hope that as we keep going back to Dar and we build relationships, that the students can go there and not simply be observers, that they might participate in some kind of a planning exercise or do some work for a client or an agency, that they would be able to do in a short period of time. So that's what we're hoping to move towards. At this point, what this is serving is simply to expose our students to what's going on in parts of the world that simply weren't part of our curriculum for a long time. Yeah.
There has been quite the fight going on in the journals about the IMF and the World Bank pushing for places that have customary law, which is what it seems that this has, to privatization and individual property. And of course that has implications down the line for the ownership of a piece of land when somebody dies and who inherits and how that passes along. Where is Tanzania in all of this? Is it?
I'm not aware of, the World Bank is a strong partner in this infrastructure upgrading effort of the country. So they're the major funder of it. The woman who has day-to-day responsibility for the operations in many of these places is in hourly contact with her World Bank colleague, and so they're a very involved partner. But there isn't much of a movement toward, there is not an aggressive movement toward codifying kind of land ownership. I think that has either been seen as not the most important priority at the moment, or simply not necessary for the types of improvements there. And if they are moving in that direction, they're a long way away from it.
I was curious about the timing of this infrastructure push when the World Bank kind of partners with them. When did this take place? And how are the Tanzanian state, I guess maybe more probably like this Dar city government, are they trying to position their city in certain ways within this new kind of infrastructural wave, and how are they imagining that? And then also, what kinds of demands are being made by the citizenry around infrastructure, or are these being defined by other kinds of interests?
I will say that the city does have plans, there's a comprehensive plan for the city that has been in place for many years. It has been honored mostly in breach, however. That is that development has rarely, and the city has rarely acted on the kinds of plans that it has made. It has some ambitious plans for the Kikamboni area right across the inlet from the city center, to create a new residential and commercial and recreational center, because you've got a beachfront as well. And right now it's really quite underdeveloped. The city understands the importance of the beaches and the tourist locations on the peninsula up here, and sort of high-end residential activity. There's certainly a differentiation of land uses, and the city wants to continue to develop, but it's extremely constrained by resources. And it has pursued
slum upgrading in Hana Nassif, but you know, that was 20 years ago. That was with World Bank assistance. The slum upgrading it's doing now is in various parts of the city, and that's with World Bank assistance. It depends somewhat on the presidential administration, how willing they are to engage in those kinds of partnerships with the World Bank, how aggressive they're going to be. That's going to vary from administration to administration.
Well, we'll have to end there, but it was terrific. Thank you so much.